Good evening, Critic Race. I have a small verse for you from Hebrews 4:16, which says, "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need." So let's worship our God who is amazing, strong, and mighty. But this amazing song says, "This is amazing grace." Sing with us.
All that you've done for me.
In Psalms 23, that as the deer pants for water, Lord, our souls should long for you and must long for you, Lord, because you are alone our desire, so that we can sing this song for you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for everything, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, even in this pandemic, Lord. Thank you for being our God, and thank you for not leaving us aside, Lord Jesus. We just want to worship you.
As the deer panted for the water, so my soul longed after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
Let's do it one more time.
As the deer panted for the water, so my soul is after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. My shield to you. to worship you. For you alone are my heart's desire, and alone to worship. To you alone may my spirit heal. For you alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. For you alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. Yes, God, you alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. Yes, you alone are my heart's desire, and I want to worship you. Yes, God, Lord, you are alone, our heart is our God, and Lord, we seek for you, Lord. We ask for you, Lord, that today whatever we hear from the message, Father, is from you and by you and through you, Lord. Thank you for our pastor, Pastor Tu, for his life, for amazing, encouraging heart you have given to him. We ask you to lead him and lead a strong Father in your coming kingdom, Lord. We just give this time and ask for you to lead all of us in the service, and you minister to us today, Lord. In your name, Lord, I pray.
And then one day find the war within, and then as death gives way to victory, I see the lights of glory and I know He lives, because He lives, I can face tomorrow, because He lives, all fear is gone, because I know. And life is worth the living just because He lives.
Good evening, Greater Grace, and welcome to our Sunday evening service. And it's a joy to be once again with you, and hope you've had a great week. And as we have remembered and grown in what we've heard in the last 2 weeks, we just pray that these messages have been important, and we have learned how, and we are continuously learning how to hear the voice of God. Now, today we want to do an encouraging message. We want to talk about a promise that God gives us in the scripture, and it's a promise that is valuable, it's a promise that's precious, and it's a promise that sooner or later we will all need it. And before we get into the message, I also want to congratulate all the fathers. It's Father's Day today. And as we think about all the dads and their sacrifices and the love, taking care of the family, we just want to honor all the fathers and all the dads that are in the church. And don't ever forget that when we all talk about fathers, we first talk about God our Father who is in heaven, who is the one because of whom we are here. We also remember and think about spiritual father, our pastor, and also the men and who have made a difference in our lives through the teaching of the Word of God. And we want to thank God for their lives. And in a way, they are our spiritual daddies, if I would say so, because we all have one spiritual father. We don't have many fathers. But all the men of God that have imparted wisdom, taught us the scriptures, we thank God for their lives. And also, we thank you for being faithful fathers, and we want to continue to pray for our dad, grandfathers, to be fathers, and just enjoy this day. This is your day, and as we are meeting in the and we are speaking in the evening, you probably had a great day already, but whatever is left of it in this part, just have a blessed day ahead. Okay, so let's pray before we begin. Okay, so Father, Lord, we just want to thank you this evening once again for this privilege, for this time together that you've given us. And as we read and understand and go through this promise that you've given us, Lord, we pray that every promise from above is great, is wonderful, is precious, exceedingly great promises. They are precious promises, valuable promises, and each one of them holds good to our life. And we thank you for all the words that you've spoken to us, and all the days of our life that you ordain our steps. You see what is good for us, and you are protecting us, and you're providing for us, and you're bringing all things to together for our good and for your glory. So continually we pray and we thank you for all that you're doing. Bless the words to our hearts, bless this portion of scripture to our hearts, and continue to use us for your glory. And pray for the finances of the church. We pray for the opening up of the church. Father, we pray for this pandemic to be cured once and for all. We just ask for divine intervention in the many details that we have today, Lord. And once again, encourage us this evening. Strengthen us. Give us boldness. Give us joy. Give us unity in every area and decisions of our life. We commit this time to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay. All right. Before we get to the text, the scriptures that I want to read, whenever we think of this promise, we know that, as a believer, we cannot live without promises. That's an important criteria for every individual, every Christian to know. That being a Christian, we cannot live without the promises. Because not just the promise, but the author of the promise, Jesus Christ. That God has thousands of promises in Scripture. And each one of this is yes and amen in Christ Jesus for us. And we are learning and we have to learn to live based on the promises of God. And God has put the scriptures, these promises in the Bible for us so that we may not lose hope, we may not lose our confidence, but we would have a confidence in Christ, the things that Christ is doing in our life. And each promise is based on the nature and character of God. It's not just promises or words. This is based on the nature and character of God. And if after John 3:16 there is a promise that brings comfort, that brings strength to a believer, it's Romans 8:28. And that's the verse that we're going to talk about tonight. That this is a word of encouragement. And we must always remember that, you know, you can take how God works, and you can take any situation in life. And God has a promise for every situation. But there are some unique promises that God has put in the scriptures that work for us, that give us understanding and a hope and faith. And we see the grace of God in those promises and the work of God in those promises. And Romans 8:28 is that kind of a promise. That you can take any situation in life and you can put a Romans 8:28 on it. Like R.A. Torrey said, that it's a soft pillow for a tired heart. And I love that. It's a soft pillow for a tired heart. But I like to think of it as an amazing promise of grace. This is an amazing promise of grace. And we learn to depend upon God. We learn to believe God. We learn to trust God when we understand the nature and character of God and understand His promises. And, you know, this verse very simply, it says, "And we know that all things, that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love Him." You know, and to those who are called according to His purpose. And we'll break up this promise and talk about it. And you know, when we live life, we see many things going on in our lives. There are ups, there are downs, and where are we going? What's the future? What's going to happen today? How will I manage? And all those things that come into our minds. You know, what does the future hold with this pandemic going on? You know, what about my job and what about my business and will the economy revive? Will there a cure be found? How long will we have to live in a lockdown? And like, these are many things that are going on in people's minds and hearts today. And we're beginning to talk about something that's called a new normal. You know, we hear in the last few days promising people that people thought were doing well in life have, you know, for unknown reasons committed suicide. And we don't know the real, because they probably had no hope. They probably were in depression. They didn't know whom to turn to. But as a Christian, we know whom we can turn to. As a Christian, we know that there is a God in heaven that who is always available for us. And so we cannot lose hope. You know, we see the situations on the border going on, and we like, is there going to be a war? Or all those things can come into our mind. But we have to think at the back of our mind, listen, there is a God who knows what He is doing, and whatever He does will be for our good and for His glory. And that's the promise, that's the premise, that's the foundation of the Romans 8:28. That it is God who is working. And you can take an example of a car factory. You know, and there is a huge factory, and there is assembly lines in the factory. And there are different parts, different places, you know, nuts, bolts, springs, you know, boxes and chairs and, you know, different things are going on, but they're all working towards a purpose. Now, when the things enter into the factory, they come in different ways. They come in parts, they come in. Standing outside the factory, we can never imagine what the end product is going to be like. But we know that when these parts go in, then there is an assembly line, things fall into place, and the product, final product, is a car. But standing on the outside, we have no idea, but we know that on the inside, there is an assembly line that's going. Things are moving backward and forward and up and down, and it seems like a contradiction going on, but they're all moving towards a purpose. And there is a planner who has done all this, and this is working now. But we see the end product. But we can be very confused if we see the things that are moving inside. And we can wonder, how is this going to come together? And that's how life is. That's how Romans 8:28 needs to be interpreted, that we cannot understand those things. But because of this promise, we can understand that God is doing something good. And I was just thinking and reading this promise, and I was reading a story of John Newton's life, who wrote this song that we love to sing, Amazing Grace. It's amazing that we can remember that song and remember its words, and comfort comes to our heart. And in November of 1754, 2 days before John Newton was going to captain a brand new ship called the Bee, he was sitting down and having his tea with his wife, and suddenly he collapsed. He fell down, lost consciousness, and people came running thinking that he's dead. And they tried to revive him, and then they found out sooner or later, when he came back to consciousness, that it was an epileptic seizure. And because it was an epileptic seizure, he could no longer captain the ship. And he had to resign, and he lost being the captain of the ship. And he began to question God. He says, God, this is the only thing I know how to do. What will I do now? And 2 weeks later, the news came in that there was a revolt on the ship. And the fight broke out. And the captain of the ship was killed. And John Newton began to think, this is what God wanted, and that's why he kept me away from it. As soon as he recovered, his wife fell sick, and she would be sick for the next 11 months. And he wasn't sure, no one knew whether she would survive or no. And as time went by, he ran out of money. He got a job as a tide surveyor in a place called Liverpool. But to take up the job, he had to leave home. And he did not want to leave home because his wife was sick. And torn between those two things, he said, okay, they decided that he would go and take up this job so that he could support the family. And he did that. He went away with a heavy heart, thinking that he will never be able to see his wife again. And 2 months later, the Lord healed his wife overnight, and there was no sickness remaining. Everything was gone, and she was like as nothing had happened. And John Newton learned that God was working in his life, even though, he could not see it. And that's the lesson this Romans 8:28 teaches us, that God is working even though we cannot see it. And this promise, I'm going to talk about it, is not so that we need to understand that everything in life is not a coincidence, it's not a chance, it's not luck. God doesn't work those ways, and those words are not to be there in the Christian's vocabulary, but the word promise is to be in the Christian's vocabulary. And this is why we can understand what God does, and sometimes we can say that, we may not, but we go back to the word, we go back to the promises of God, and the promises of God give us an understanding, and the promises of God give us comfort, and they give us a hope to know and understand what God can do. And this is what we think of when we go to this book, because, you can, like, for example, you can take the book of Esther and you can search for the word, and there is no God mentioned in that book. But, every page you turn, you see God in the book of Esther. And I love this because this is what R.A. Torrey would say, This promise of Romans 8:28 is like a soft pillow for a tired heart. And sooner or later, we will all need it. Sooner or later, we will all need this promise. And the Lord will be looking at us and saying, this is my word for everyone. I don't know the author, but one of them, I think was it Spurgeon, or I don't know who it was, who said that you can take a book and write down it everything that you've gone through, going through, and the imaginations of your heart and all that is going on, and troubles and ups and downs and everything that goes on in life, and then you shut the book and stick Romans 8:28 on it, and it'll be true. And I would like to think like that, that's how we can understand, maybe when things go and happen that we don't know, then how do we understand it? We understand it through the word of God. So let's begin, in Romans 8:28, and the first part of this promise says, and we know. And this is beautiful because, and we know, the Christian knows, it's this inside information. We somehow have inside information. We know God does those things. We know that God is involved. We never lose sight of that promise that we know, the Christian knows, we know. And this is the beauty, because how do we know? Because God has given us His Word. God has given us His promises in His Word, and that's why we know what God is doing. And in Isaiah 46 verse 10, it says, God knows the end from the beginning. Like, it's through the scriptures. When I go through the scriptures, then I can understand how God can work. I can understand what God does. And these words in the scripture are just not just letters, but they bring us comfort and strength for any time. And that's how we know, because we are students of the Word, because we love the Bible. And it's the Bible that brings and gives us an understanding. It's refreshing. It brings comfort. It brings joy. You know, it opens up my mind to trust God, to praise Him in situations, to worship Him, to love Him, you know, to be encouraged, because we know. We have an inside information. We have an inside information. We can pray and believe God, and God will do things that we can never expect. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 20, the way He works is beyond what we can ask or think. Like, this is not the way we know to do things, but God knows how He is doing. And that's why whenever we make decisions in life, they are not based on emotions. They are based on the Word. They are with prayer, understanding, knowing that this is what God is calling us to do, you know. The promise is based on the promiser. Because God is involved, that's why we know. That's why that gives us strength. That gives us strength and understanding that this is what God is doing. And we know that God causes all things. And I love that word, all things. Not limited things, not a few things, not a selected few things, but all things. All things. Where God causes all things to work together. And this is great, because what I mean by all things is that it includes everything in life. And sometimes we are prone to leave certain details out of our life, thinking that God, I don't think, is interested in this. God is not working in this. Why would God use this? And these are situations and questions that we can have as a human being in our mind, thinking, well, listen, you know, why would God use this situation? Why would God bring this circumstance into picture? Why would God use my children or me or my family or my job or, you know, all my finances or my in-laws and, you know, all those things? Why would He use my good days and why would He use my bad days? And we can limit our mind to saying that, you know, certain things can be used by God, but we need to understand the promise that, you know, God is saying all things. And this does not mean that, you know, a person, a Christian, can live the way he wants to live and then God will turn it around and make it good. No, if a person is living in sin and they are trying to use grace as a license to sin, then the chastising will come, the discipline will come. This is not a promise that's saying, you know, live, do as you please, live as you want, and then God will turn around. No, it's based on scriptures. It's based on scriptures and the nature and character of God. And yes, we can have bad days, and yes, we can have bad moments. And it is in the hands of the sovereign God that He can take those bad moments and those bad days, you know, and use them for His good, for our good and for His glory. So God uses all things in our lives, and there is no restriction. There is no limitation for God when He begins to work in our life. And He is working in our life. And so He uses all things. Nothing is by chance. Nothing is a coincidence. God is working. And this should comfort the believer. For you and me, this should comfort us that all things means all things. Not a selected or not my human understanding, but all things. God is working. And what is He doing? God causes all things to do what? Work together. Synergy. Work together. Synergeo. Work together. Like, they are working together. If one horse can pull 500 kilos, how many kilos can two horses pull? And the people could say, oh, 1,000. No, but what does synergy mean? One horse can pull 500 kilos, but two put together can pull probably 1,500 to 1,700 kilos. Oh, wait. Because you're working together, various elements on the different side, when they're brought together, can bring an amount of result. And my favorite illustration of working together is salt. Like we use it every day. And we know what it's made of, right? Sodium and chloride. But if I have both those things separately, I could die. But if I put them together, if then they're put together, then what happens? The poison is taken out. And the result is salt. They are working together. You put those two things, wrong things, which are not beneficial for us, you put them together, and the result is something that you need every day. We need grace every day. We need faith every day. We need the love of God every day. We need hope every day. We need the promises of God every day. We need the working of the Holy Spirit in our life every day. Every day. And so whatever things we know, you know, they're all things are working together. It's for us. That God is putting these things together. You know, there is nothing that is by chance. And we can look at this illustration in John chapter 11 where Lazarus is dead and Jesus says it's not time for us to go. He hears the news that he is sick, but he says it's not the time for us to go. But he is sick now, but we need to go. But it's not the time. And then the news came. And then after 2 days, Jesus goes with the disciples and they're saying, but it's too late now. You know, and he when they reach, he's dead. He's been buried already. I wish we were on time. Wish you had come before. And Jesus says, listen, this is for God's glory. Jesus brings glory to God. And he would say those words, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus would come forth. The dead man is raised back to life at the word of Christ. And so there is a sickness that was happening and then there is a death that took place. But it worked together for good to bring glory to God. And of course, Lazarus was happy that he was back. You know, and I think that's how God works these things together. They don't seem to make sense. They don't seem to be working together. And logically, how can those two things work together and something good come out of it? Because both on their own are bad. You know? But God does those things. And how can this synergy take place? How can one horse that pulls 500 and put two together and 1500 can be pulled? It's greater than what they thought it would be. But this is how God works. But when he puts those all things together, then a greater result is produced, a greater faith is produced, a greater love is produced, an experience of his grace is understood, and we know and we begin to believe and we say, Lord, this is you, and no one else can do it but it is you. And this is how God works, because the work of God is supernatural. It's not something that I can say I understand. But it's God who is doing it, that's what I know. He's involved, he's working, he's writing, you know. And the resurrection took place. The disciples heard it, but they went back fishing. But when they met with Christ, their lives changed. And sometimes we know theory, we know things, but we need to meet Christ in the situation. And that changes everything. Like I was thinking, you know, they know the resurrection, they saw the risen Christ, and yet they went back shipping. They went back to their ships. They went back to fishing. You know, they went back to those things. But when meeting with Christ changed everything. We need to meet Christ. We need to see him working. We need to see his hand in our lives. And, you know, he takes the good, the bad, the nice, the not so nice, the pleasant, the unpleasant, and he puts them together. He is working all things. Why is he working for it? It says this verse here, for good. For good. Nothing bad. It's not a bad plan. God is not doing anything that is not good for you. It's not that he's angry with you. You know, he's working all the time for your good. And I was thinking about the home that we used to stay in Baltimore whenever I went for convention there, and the family there had a jigsaw puzzle and it was on a table. And, you know, and they were putting it together. And in front of the table was a picture of how it has to look. And all the pieces are there, and it was there. And And then I went back next year and the puzzle was not complete. And I was like, what's going on? How did it take so long? They said, no, we were not working on it, but let's working on it. And it was like a 2,000-3,000 piece puzzle, and they were putting it together, and it was beginning to fall into shape. And it was interesting to see how the puzzle is being put together. Because we have a clear picture, but then there is a puzzle there, and there are so many pieces. How do you bring them together? Little by little, little by little. And that's how God works for us. It's the good. It's for our good. But how does it happen? I don't know. Little by little. Little by little, God things together. It's a puzzle. But the result is good. It's for our good and it's for His glory. And God will not hold it back. God will not hold it back. He does all things for our good. You know, I don't know. I've shared this illustration many times of the pastor. And you know, remember that when there was a pastor who had a van, old run-down van. And, you know, he would use it for his buying and grocery and selling his vegetables during the week, and on the weekend he would use it as a pickup vehicle and go pick up people and take them to church. And being the pastor, he was praying that, Lord, we need this van needs a fresh coat of paint, it needs new tires, it needs benches inside, the van's getting old and not very useful, and we need to get repairs. And as he's praying, and then he finds out that the van is stolen. He gets up the next day and says, the van's gone. And he's like, Lord, what a great sense of humor you have. You know, that I've been praying that this is the only resource that we can use for my business and for also bringing people to church, and it's stolen now. So he goes, registers a complaint in the police station, and we remember that story. And I like that, because 2 weeks later he gets a phone call from the police, your van has been found. They come to the place, they've caught the thief, and they show him the van. And he says, this is not my van. This is not my van. It's like, this is, you know, the color is different. The brand new tires here. My van did not have brand new tires. Inside of the van is like, there are new benches and there is no seats put up and everything's there. There's a sound system there. And, you know, this is not my van. He says, no. This is your van. The thief who stole it, you know, remodeled the whole thing, redid the whole thing, made it brand new, and he got caught. And the pastor was like smiling, and this verse came back to his mind. You know, this verse came back to his mind, and that's how sometimes we can be. You know, sometimes we can look at the blessing and we can look at the answer and we say, no, this is not what God can do. This is not the way of God. This is not the work of God. And then you realize, but it is, you know, and God has brought it back. And some, like, our human heart sometimes work that way, that the answer to what you have asked for is in front of you and you don't believe it. And we can live like that, but we remember, because it's not based on what we do. It's based on the faithfulness of God. It's based on the work of God and the love of God, you know. And He works those things. And remember, it is always for your good. It will be always for His glory, but always for your good. That's how God works. That's His way. And then the last portion of the verse, to those who love God and are called according to His purpose. What's God's purpose? It's found in verse 29, that we would be, you know, conformed into the image of His Son. Isn't that a beautiful purpose for our lives? That we would become a little bit more like Jesus every day. And remember, it's a conditional promise to those who believe, to those who love God. This is a promise for the believer. It's not for an unbeliever. To those who love God and are called according to His purpose, those who have received Christ, to them God works all things together for good. You know, and to those who love God, so they'll be called according to His purpose, to be more into the image of His Son, to be like His Son, to conform us into His image. And sometimes to conform into the image of Son, God uses different things in our life. And we may not understand them, but we know, we trust God, because we know that this is God who is working in our life, you know. And I was thinking of the story of Job, the way it began and the way it ended. And in the middle, there is so much going on. And he's a righteous man. He loves God. But then there is the work of the enemy. There are situations and things that are happening. And he holds on to his faith. He holds on to the word. He holds on to the promise. My Redeemer lives. And one day I will stand before Him. That's the promise that he faces. And he hangs on to it. And in the end, we see everything being doubled in the life of Job. And that's our life too. You can look at any person in the Bible. You can look at their life and you can read their lives. And you know, you can see, oh, this seems to be the end for him. This, nothing is going right. But then you turn a few pages and you see God is working. And that's how it is with us. That we turn a few pages, wait for a little while, wait for the pages to turn over, and you will see what God is doing. And you will see what God is doing. Why? Because we love God and we are called according to His purpose, and God wants us to be conformed into the image of His Son. Christ is being formed in us, and that's the beautiful part. Like, we cannot understand completely, fully, deeply the work of God, but we know that God is working things together for our good and for His glory. Because we are children of God. And God is not upset with us. God is not angry with us. God is a patient, loving Father. And nothing separates us from His love. And whatever He is doing it to make us into the image of His Son. That's amazing victory for the believer. You know, amazing victory that we at times we can come in into the presence of God and we can say to God, "You know best. You are working. And you are making me like His Son." And that's so amazing that, you know, that God would do these things in our lives. And that's why I want everyone to be encouraged tonight. These weeks when we've been talking to people and we are looking at the news and there is nothing to hope for. Yes, there is a little bit of a glimmer that some drug is beginning to work in critically ill patients. But overall, the people are wondering and questioning, like, when will this be over? Is this the new normal? How do we go forward? Will these cases rise, go down? How will health be? And, you know, what about the job scene? And what about economy? And how is the future holding? What about the kids' education? So many things are revolving. So many things are going on. So many words, so many thoughts, so many plans. Everything is moving around. Everything is moving around. But then we have the word. Then we have the promise of God. That God is saying, "Hey, listen. Turn your eyes to me. Be encouraged. I am here. I am working. Nothing has surprised me. Nothing is a shock for me. I am still here. I am still working. I am still involved. And what I am doing will bring me good. It's good for you." And over the weeks, I've been hearing these testimonies of how, you know, things were not working, but then a door opened. A provision came through. You know, God helped. And something that was not, people were not expecting, that happened. And a test result which was fearful that came in good. And there is no reason to fear now. Somebody got healed. Somebody got, you know, the provisions met. And, you know, those things. And it's amazing to see that even in midst of that seems to be everything is blocked, that there are little doors, there are little windows. You're seeing the fingers of God move and the work of God happening. And that brings joy, that brings comfort, that brings strength to believe again, to trust Him more, to have hope, to continue moving forward, to continue growing, to continue loving and trusting God and the work that He has called us to do. Because there is a work. That there is a movement of God, that there is a fingers of God, the hand of God that is there. And He has not left us, and He doesn't plan to. And He continues to work. So be encouraged, be strengthened. You know, there is something going on that God is doing in each one of our lives individually. And we pray in the days to come that the church would be able to meet soon as a church. We would be able to fellowship again, love again, have our potlucks and picnics and those things. Trust God. You know, be encouraged and strengthened. So let's pray. Father, we thank You this evening for Your word, for Your work in our lives, for the way, beautiful ways that You do things in our life, God, that many of those things are unknown to us. We do not know them, but we know that Your promises of God are given to us so that we can trust You and understand that You are deeply working in our lives. And we thank You once again for the body of Christ. We thank You for each and every member of the church, for their love, for their grace. And we once again want to remember our dads and want to say Happy Father's Day to every dad. And we, you know, want to thank them for their lives and for the love that they have for us and the way they have sacrificed and the things that they have done to keep this family together. We remember that God, you are our Father and you know all things. And so we want to give this time, these our lives, our church, our work, our families into your hands. We want to say, Lord, take us through. Take us through these moments and continue to bless us and encourage us and use us for your glory, God. Once again, we give these times and these moments into your hands, Father. We thank you that we have a promise that we can hang on to. That any situation can take place, but there is a word of God. There is a promise of God that is enough for us. And Lord, thank you for this promise. Thank you that you are using all things to work together for good, to conform us into the image of your Son. We love you. We worship you, Jesus. If anyone's watching this program for the first time and you do not know where you will go after you die, know this, that God is a holy God and man's sin separates man from a holy God. And if we die in our sins, the Bible says that we will never be in heaven again. We'll never be able to go to heaven. And but we don't want, but God loves us. And so that's why he sent his Jesus to die for the sins of the world. And if you want to be sure of going to heaven, you just have to say a simple prayer in your heart. Say, Jesus, save me. Thank you for dying for my sins. I am a sinner. I put my trust in you. I accept you as my Lord and Savior. Thank you for dying for my sins on the cross. I believe that you were died on the cross for my sins. You were buried. You rose again. You're alive today. Accept me in your family. I want to be a child of God. You can say that prayer in your heart and accept Jesus into your life and you become a child of God. You are accepted into his family and you can be sure of going to heaven. And connect with someone who goes to church, get a Bible and read and be encouraged with the promises of God. There is a plan and purpose of God for you also. Right, so let's pray. Father, we pray for this week ahead. Once again, Lord, we just pray that you will continue to use us, build us up, encourage us, strengthen us, and help us grow in our faith, in wisdom, in love, in the grace of God, in the mercy of God. And we just pray and thank you that there are amazing promises, precious promises given to us. And this promise of amazing promise of grace, we pray that you will remember this amazing promise of grace in our hearts. Continue to bless us and use us and be magnified in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Have a blessed week ahead and may this word encourage you, strengthen you, and never forget this promise. Amen.
Hope you like the message. The last song says, Ah, God is great. So sing with us and praise our God.
Turn into wine, open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness we shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God.
Powerful and strong, Lord. We just ask you, Lord, Father, for the whole week, for the everyone in the church, Father, Lord, wherever they are, Lord, in their house, or maybe some of them are walking, Lord. I just pray for their lives, Lord, and ask you, Lord, that you protect them, Father. You lead them, Father, and I just pray, Lord, that you minister to them through this message, Lord, you made the word. We ask you, Lord, to lead us and guide and every one of us, Lord, you protect us, Lord Jesus. And we just want to thank you and ask you so, Lord, we can walk in you and walk with you, Lord Jesus, and walk through you, Father. We just ask for your mercy and we ask you to, Lord, just protect us for the whole week, Lord. And thank you just for everything, Lord. Just give this week into your hand in your name, Lord, I pray.